Welcome to the class of social science for history class 7 chapter 3. The name of the chapter is Delhi Sultanate. I repeat, the name of the chapter is Delhi Sultanate. Now let us understand what is Delhi Sultanate. Delhi Sultanate were the Persian speaking dynasties of Turkic and Afghan origin, which were controlling India from 1210 to 1526. Many of the dynasties ruled from Delhi. Okay, Delhi was not a small place, or it was not a important place for anyone. Right now at present we are having as a Delhi capital, but Delhi was an important place since a long time before. Okay, it started from the Indraprastha. You know Indraprastha, the capital of where the Pandavas used to live. Okay, that was the Delhi place. Delhi was been renamed. Previously it was named as Indraprastha. Okay, the dynasties were at the Delhi Sultanate were Mamluk dynasty, Khilji dynasty, Tughlaq dynasty, Sayyid dynasty and Lodi dynasties. These six dynasties, they all ruled India, ruled Delhi, okay, in India from 1210 to 1526. These all dynasties were from the dynasties of Turkic or from the Afghan side. The Mamluk dynasty ruled from 1206 to 1290. Then after Mamluk dynasty, it came the Khilji dynasty. Khilji dynasty ruled from 1290 to 1320. Then came for the Tughlaq dynasty, which ruled from 1320 to 1413. After that, it came the Sayyid dynasty. The Sayyid dynasty ruled from 1414 to 1451. And then lastly came with the Lodi dynasty, 1451 to 1526. And after that, slowly and steadily, the Mughal Empire came to India and they conquered India and they started ruling. Now, Mughal Empire was totally very different from the Delhi Sultanate. Now, look at this flowchart. In this flowchart, you will understand nicely about the dynasties of Delhi Sultanate. Okay, first came with the Mamluk dynasty, the time period 1206 to 1290. Then the Khilji dynasty that came from 1290 to 1320. After that, Tughlaq dynasty, 1320 to 1440. Then it came Sayyid dynasty, 1414 to 1451, and lastly it came with the Lodi dynasty, 1451 to 1526. Students, you have to draw this flowchart in a notebook regarding the Delhi Sultanate. Okay, write the names properly with the dynasties and also learn the dates from which period to which period the dynasties ruled in the Delhi Sultanate. Now let me tell you about the rise of the Delhi Sultanate. Okay, it how it created. Qutbuddin Aibak, a former slave, was the first Sultan of Delhi, and later his dynasties captured a large area of the northern India. And after that, the Khilji dynasty were also able to conquer most of the central India. And then the Sultanate took several steps to defeat the Mughal Empire. But finally, the Mughal Empire overturned them. It means they captured them, okay? They overruled them. They win the areas and they ruled India. The Delhi Sultanate also introduced the Indo-Muslim cultures, resulting education, literature, music and poetry, okay? All these things are not only introduced in the Mughal time, but they were previously introduced by the Delhi Sultanate people. Delhi Sultanate was the only first empire or we can say it was the first only empire where the female rulers ruled. Okay, Razia Sultan, who was from the slave dynasty. Okay, she was the daughter of Iltutmish, and she was the first lady ruler of India. Okay, she was a very prominent ruler, and she just shown herself that the ladies can also rule very nicely. But misfortunately, as at that time the ladies ruler were not being made, okay, the people didn't like the ladies ruler, so she was being killed, okay, by her own family members, okay, by her own relatives. But still she made her, in a very short duration of 4 years, she made and showed her her ruling capacity, that she was among the finest rulers of India. Now, the first dynasty that ruled the Delhi Sultanate was the Mamluk dynasty. Now, this Mamluk dynasty was founded by Muhammad Ghori. Okay, Muhammad Ghori, who actually came from Afghanistan to India, and he tried to conquer the some parts of India. And as he started conquering, what he found that his army was not as much strong as the Indian ones. So what he did, he went back to make his army more stronger. Now, at that time, you know, the kings or the rulers who were being overruled, okay, who were being conquered by another king, they were being all coming in the slaves, okay, they all become used to become the slaves. Now, you know what, the slaves were more liable and trustworthy in comparison to other people. So before leaving the dynasties like this in India, Muhammad Ghori appointed Qutbuddin Aibak over here, and he said that you take care of this area, okay, till the time I return. Now, as Muhammad Ghori went back over there, he felt sick and he died. Now, here in Delhi, okay, Qutbuddin Aibak, okay, he started ruling the nation, okay, and he made his dynasty, own dynasty, which was named as Slave Dynasty, That is why the Qutbuddin Aibak dynasty is named as Slave Dynasty. Qutbuddin Aibak, okay, he was the successor of Aram Shah. Iltutmish, who was a subedar of Badu and son-in-law of Aram Shah. And Razia Sultan, the daughter of Iltutmish. They were the rulers of the slave dynasty. Mostly, Qutbuddin Aibak was among the finest rulers of India in the slave dynasty. He was very kind-hearted and a very good ruler. Now, Qutbuddin Aibak were having 4 daughters. He was not having any son. So, when he was about to die, okay, he made, among the 4 daughters, there were only 1 son-in-law who was really as humorous, as trustworthy, as nice, as good person as Qutbuddin Aibak, and that was Iltutmish. So, after the death of Qutbuddin Aibak, he appointed Iltutmish as his successor, and Iltutmish ascended the throne of the same dynasty. And Iltutmish became the ruler of the slave dynasty. Qutbuddin Aibak was really a very nice ruler. And you know what? Just to show the overpower, okay, the power, the authority, the supremacy of the slave dynasty, he started making the minar known as Qutb Minar. Qutb Minar was named after the Qutbuddin Aibak of slave dynasty. And as the Qutb Minar was being made, it was under construction, Qutbuddin Aibak, okay, he expired. And Iltutmish, after becoming the ruler of the slave dynasty, Iltutmish continued this construction work of Qutbuddin Aibak on the request of his mother-in-law, and he completed the building of the Qutb Minar. Qutb Minar, which is said to be the most tallest building among the monuments of Indian history and in the world also. Okay. Now, after Iltutmish was a very nice ruler. Okay, he was as good and as humble as Qutbuddin Aibak, and he tried to follow all the policies and the reforms whatever his father-in-law had made, and he tried to add on more new good things to for his kingdom and for his people. Razia Sultan, who was the daughter of Iltutmish, she was also a very brave and a brilliant and intelligent girl. Okay, she also became a good ruler and a prominent ruler who really worked for the people, for her kingdom, instead of thinking about its own self or becoming greedy. Now see the flowchart of the state dynasty. Qutbuddin Aibak, who ruled from 1206 to 1210 AD, and then came for the Arab Shah Qutbuddin, who ruled from 1210 to 1211, just only for 1 year, and after that Iltutmish became the ruler, who ruled from 1211 to 1236 AD. And then Iltutmish. Now Iltutmish was, you know what, he was having 4 sons and 1 daughter. Now in that 4 sons and 1 daughter, Razia Sultan was a daughter and 4 others were the son. Now Rukuddin Firoz Shah, who was the eldest son of Iltutmish, he tried to ascend the throne, okay, after the death of his father, but he did not continue for a longer period, and after that Razia Sultan was being made as a ruler. Rukuddin Firoz Shah ruled from only just for a very few months, 1236 AD. After that, Razia Sultan ruled for 4 years, 1236 to 1240 AD. And then came Musuddin Bahram. Musuddin Bahram was actually the cousin of Razia Sultan. He was also a good ruler and tried to continue with the policies of Iltutmish, and he ruled for 2 years, 1240 to 1242 AD. After that, Ghizauddin Barghan, who came for the ruler, who also a very good ruler, okay, of the Safed dynasty, and he was among the relatives of Razia Sultan. He ruled from 1266, okay, to 1286, and lastly came for the Musuddin Qayyubuddin. Now he was among those ruler who was actually the from the army department, okay, the ruling, the subedar, okay, and he ruled from 1287 to 1290 AD, and after that the state dynasty came to an end. Now students, let me show you this Qutub Minar. Qutub Minar, which is said to be one of the greatest monuments of the Indian history, and it is made in the Mamluk dynasty, okay, started by Qutbuddin Aibak, okay, and which was ended, the construction work was ended by the Iltutmish, the son-in-law of Qutbuddin Aibak, and it was among the finest buildings of India. And you know what, this Qutub Minar was actually being made to show the power and the energy, okay, the rulership, the strongest empire of India, that was the slave dynasty. Next come with the Khilji dynasty. The term Khilji was their designation, means a Turkic language. It means swordsman. It means the man with having the swords in their hand. Okay, although they had played a conspicuous role in the success of the Turkic armies in India, they had always been looked down upon by the leading Turks, the dominant group during the slave dynasty. Okay, Khilji dynasty, they all came from the Turkic, okay, which actually means the swordsmen. The term Khilji means swordsmen according to the Turkic language, okay. And these usually people were the people belonging to the dynasty which were already conquering the places with the help of the sword, okay. They were the leading Turks during the slave dynasty. After the slave dynasty, when the slave dynasty was going on, the Turks came into India, and they all named as them the Khiljis okay, and these Khiljis, they all started overruling the slave dynasty and finally conquered them, and they started ruling the India, and they all came up with the name of Khilji dynasty. Jalaluddin Khilji, 1290 to 1296 AD. Jalaluddin Khilji, who was the founder of the Khilji dynasty, okay, and he ruled in India for about 1290 to 1296, it means for 6 years. He followed mild and generous policies. This generous policy of the Sultan affected the foreign policy. In 1290, he invaded the fort of Ranthambore, and in 1294, Alauddin, the nephew of Jalaluddin, invaded Ramchandra, the ruler of Devanagari in the south. Okay, during the Khilji dynasty, the expansion of the Delhi Sultanate extended. Okay, they expanded their empire, not only limited to the Delhi areas but also to the southern areas. Okay, so 1290 he invaded the fort of Ranthambore. Okay, and in 1294 Alauddin, who was a nephew of Jalaluddin Khilji, he invaded the Ramchandra, ruler of Devanagari in the south. Now coming to Alauddin Khilji, who ruled from 1296 to 1316 AD. He was the nephew and son-in-law of Jalaluddin Khilji. Now, what he did to become the king of the Khilji dynasty, he killed Jalaluddin Khilji and ascended the throne. Okay, in 1296, he was the first Turkish Sultan of Delhi who separated religion from politics. Okay. He made totally a different thing. Politics is very different from the religion, so both the things should be made separately. The most important experiment by Alauddin Khilji was the attempt to control markets. Okay, Alauddin Khilji tried to control the markets of India and tried to expand the empire. Okay, for that, several new sort of taxes and several new policies he came and he made introduced during his reign. So Alauddin Khilji was a nephew and son-in-law Jalaluddin Khilji. He killed him and ascended the throne in 1296. He was a ruler of the Khilji dynasty for 96 years. It means 1296 or 1360. It was not for 6 years. Okay. He was the first Turkish Sultan of Delhi who separated the religion from the politics. And most importantly, he tried to control the markets as being the ruler. After Alauddin Khilji, Khusrow Khan came into existence in the Khilji dynasty. But Khusrow Khan was being killed by the Ghazni Khan. Okay, this marked as the need of the Khilji dynasty, and also it came with the rise of the Tughlaq dynasty in Delhi. Okay, now after the slave dynasty, the Khilji dynasty came, and now after the Khilji dynasty, Tughlaq dynasty came into existence in the Delhi Sultanate. After the Khilji dynasty, another dynasty that came into existence was Tughlaq dynasty. Tughlaq dynasty, which was among the most prominent dynasties of the Delhi Sultanate, and it also been, you know, in Delhi there is a place, a proper area, it has been named as Tughlaqabad. Okay, Tughlaqabad was actually the prominent area where the rulers of the Tughlaq dynasty resided. Okay, this was the Tughlaq dynasty, and now let us know more about the Tughlaq dynasty. Tughlaq dynasty was basically of the Turkish dynasty, and they were from the Turkish origin. The family religion were the Muslims. In year 1321, Ghazi Tughlaq succeeded the throne, and was given the title of Ghiyath al-Din Tughlaq. Okay, Ghazi Tughlaq was the ruler of the Tughlaq dynasty. Okay, and he was given the title of Ghiyath al-Din Tughlaq. Okay, so Tughlaq dynasty was basically of the Turkish origin, and their family religion was Muslim. In the year 1321, Ghazi Tughlaq succeeded the throne and was being given the title of Ghiyath al-Din Tughlaq. I repeat, Ghiyath al-Din Tughlaq. Now, it is for the Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq. Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq, who ruled from 1320 to 1325 AD for 5 years. Khusro Khan, who was the last king of the Khilji dynasty, was killed by Ghazni Malik. And Ghazni Malik ascended the throne, assuming the title Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq. He died in an ancient, and his son Ulugh Khan succeeded him under the title Muhammad bin Tughlaq. Okay, so Ghazni Malik, he assumed the title of Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq, and his son was named as Muhammad bin Tughlaq. Their original name were of Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq had the original name Ghazni Malik, and the son Muhammad bin Tughlaq was having the name of Ulugh Khan. Okay, so Ghazni Malik killed the last ruler of the Khilji dynasty, that was the Khusro Khan, and he conquered the area and came up with a new dynasty of Tughlaq dynasty, and he assumed the title of Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq. Now, after a death in an accident, his son Ulugh Khan changed his name and named as Muhammad bin Tughlaq and succeeded the throne of the Tughlaq dynasty. Now, coming to Muhammad bin Tughlaq. Muhammad bin Tughlaq, who was the son of Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq, and his original name was Ulugh Khan. He conquered and ruled the Tughlaq dynasty from 1325 to 1351 AD. Prince Jonah, son of Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq, ascended the throne in 1325. He tried to introduce many administrative reforms to the people. Okay, under his reign, he died while campaigning in Sindh against Daki, a Turkish slave. So, Muhammad bin Tughlaq, I cannot say that Muhammad bin Tughlaq was a very bad ruler, but he was among the great rulers who really introduced many administrative reforms for the Indian culture. Okay, and for the people of his own kingdom. Now, coming to the Firoz Shah Tughlaq. Firoz Shah Tughlaq, who was a cousin of Muhammad bin Tughlaq, and he ascended the throne in 1351 and he ruled till 1388 AD. He was among the most prominent rulers of the Tughlaq dynasty. He established Diwan e Khairiyat department for poor and needy people, and also Diwan Budagan, who was a department of slaves. Students, Firoz Shah Tughlaq was a very generous and kind-hearted ruler. He not only ruled or extended the empire of Tughlaq dynasty, but he also introduced many new reforms for the poor and the slave people, especially by establishing Diwan-e-Khairiyat and Diwan-e-Bandhgan. Now, he also introduced the Itadari system. Okay, Itadari system was a revenue system. The Tughlaq dynasty would not survive much after the Firoz Shah death. Okay, after the death of Firoz Shah Tughlaq, usually the Malwa, the Gujarat and the Sharqi kingdoms, they all usually came and broke the Tughlaq dynasty into several parts. So, Firoz Shah Tughlaq was said to be the last ruler of the Tughlaq dynasty, who ruled from 1351 to 1388 AD, and he was the cousin of Muhammad bin Tughlaq. So in the Tughlaq dynasty, usually firstly it came with Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq. Okay, his original name was Ghazi Malik, who killed Khusro Khan, who was the last ruler of the Khilji dynasty. After that, Muhammad bin Tughlaq, who was the son of Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq, he ascended the throne. And after Muhammad bin Tughlaq, Firoz Shah Tughlaq came into existence, and he was the last ruler of the Tughlaq dynasty. Now, coming to the Sayyid dynasty. Sayyid dynasty, which was introduced by Khizr Khan. Okay, Khizr Khan, it was said to be a lieutenant of the Timur. Okay, and he was a Sayyid. So, this dynasty was known as Sayyid dynasty. Let us know more about Sayyid dynasty. Sayyid dynasty. Khizr Khan, a lieutenant of Timur, was a Sayyid. So, his dynasty is called Sayyid dynasty. Sayyid dynasty was usually being ruled by three rulers. Number one, Khizr Khan. Khizr Khan, who was from 1414 to 1421. It means for 7 years. Timur's nominee captured Delhi and was proclaimed and the new Sultan and first of the Sayyid dynasty. They ruled over Delhi and their surrounding districts. Then came with the Mubarak Khan. Mubarak Khan, who was from the ruler of 1421 to 1434. He succeeded Khizr at the throne after the successful expedition against Mewates. Okay, Mewates, Kathihars and the Gangetic dominance area. Okay, he was killed by the nobles in his own court. Okay, now see, Mubarak Shah was actually, he succeeded Khizr at the throne after his successful expedition against the Mewates, Khetars and the Gangetic area. So this area he conquered and he became the ruler, and he was actually being killed by the nobles in his own court. His own subordinate people killed him because they were not liking his expression at all. Alam Shah, who was the ruler from 1443 to 1451, the last Sayyid king, descended in favor of Behlol Lodi and himself retired. Thus began the Lodi dynasty, which confined to Delhi and a few surrounding areas. Alam Shah, who was the last ruler of the Sayyid dynasty. So in the Sayyid dynasty, the first ruler was Khizr Khan, then came Fath Mubarak Shah, and finally with the Alam Shah. And Alam Shah was the last ruler of the Sayyid dynasty. And after the Alam Shah, Behlol Lodi, okay, came into existence, and he named his own dynasty as Lodi dynasty. Now it comes about Lodi dynasty, which was being established by Behlol Lodi. He was among the great rulers of the Lodi dynasty and also among the last dynasties of the Delhi Sultanate. Because after that, the Delhi Sultanate came to an end, and slowly and steadily, the whole of the Delhi Sultanate came into the under the reign of the Mughal Empire. Lodi dynasty. Behlol Lodi established the Lodi dynasty and ruled from 1451 to 1526. He was previously the governor of Sarhind in Punjab under the Sultan of Delhi. Behlol Lodi first occupied the province of Punjab, and later on he tried to conquer the Delhi and became the Sultan of Delhi on 19th April 1451 under the title of Sultan Abdul Muzaffar Behlol Shah Ghazi. This was the whole name and the title he assumed for. And what was the title? The title of Sultan Abdul Muzaffar Balul Shah Qazi. I repeat, Sultan Abdul Muzaffar Balul Shah Qazi. This was the title he assumed. So Balul Lodi was the ruler of the Lodi dynasty, and he ruled from 1451 to 1526, and he was previously the governor of Sarhind in So under the Sultan of Delhi, he firstly conquered the area of Punjab, and then slowly and steadily he conquered the area of Delhi, and he assumed the title of Sultan Abdul Muzaffar Balul Shah Qazi, and he ascended the throne on 19th April 1451. And after this, the Lodi dynasty conquered the Delhi Sultanate or continued the Delhi Sultanate. But very soon, the Lodi dynasty was unable to conquer for a longer period of duration, and thus, due to the Mughal Empire, establishment of the Mughal Empire started in India, and the Delhi Sultanate came to an end. During the Delhi Sultanate, the economic conditions were very different. Agriculture was the main occupation or the major occupation at that time. Land was a source of production. Produce was generally sufficient, and the village was a self-sufficient unit. So everyone, apart from for the agriculture purposes, they were happy and they were satisfied. Industries, there were large and cottage industries. There were village and cottage industries at that time in the Delhi Sultanate. The laborers employed was the family members. It means all the members of the family usually were being in the one occupation. The technique was conservative, it means very limited, and their industries were sugar, scents and spirits. Now, next was the trade and commerce. Now, for the trade and commerce, inland and foreign trade flourished. As for the internal trade, we had the various classes of merchants and shopkeepers. Now, during the Delhi Sultanate, obviously the foreign trade started in India. Why so? Because of the mostly the rulers were belonging not from India, they were all from Afghan and the Turkey side. So just because their own merchants also were coming to India and trading. Tax system. The Sultan of Delhi Sultanate collected 5 categories of taxes which fall under the economic system of the empire. So during the Delhi Sultanate period, several sorts of tax system was also being levied or introduced by the Sultans of Delhi. Now they can be from the Slave dynasty or the Khilji dynasty or from the Lodi dynasty, Sayyid dynasty or any other dynasty. So the economic condition during the Delhi Sultanate was, we cannot say it was poor, it was very good at that time. Now, what were the reasons for the downfall of Delhi Sultanate? Number one was inherent weakness. Yes, this was among the major important downfall reason. The reason for the downfall, because their own family members, they were all, backbiting each other. They were all rivalry to each other because they wanted to ascend the throne. So they did not see that whether the ruler is my father or my cousin or my any other relative, but they just want to become a ruler. They were greedy from their mind. Absence of strong rules. Yes, during the Delhi Sultanate duration, we found that mostly the rulers were not as powerful, as good, as prominent as the good rulers should be. So just because of the absence of good ruler, the Delhi Sultanate does not to exist. Next was unenlightened policy of the government. Yes, at this time what actually happened? It happened that the government was unable to continue or introduce good policies for the people and good policies to enlarge their empire. Okay, extend their empire. Next was absence of popular support. Yes, this was also among the major reasons that the Delhi Sultanate was not having a good and a powerful support at the back. Because see, every kingdom, every dynasty can only run further, okay, it can only expand if the ruler is good, and they were not having a good ruler who can support from the back. Last one is invasion of Timur. Invasion of Timur, because after that the Lodi dynasty and the Sayyid dynasty, the Timur dynasty came, okay, and just because of the Timur dynasty, the Delhi Sultanate lost his empire and the Mughal empire started establishing itself inside India. Conclusion we find finally for the Delhi Sultanate. Above all, reading all the slides, we learn that Delhi was based sultanates, okay, mostly of the all the sultans in, who were residing in Delhi, they were mostly of Turkic and Afghan origin in the medieval India. The sultanates ruled from Delhi from between 1206 to 1526. It means around 326 years the Delhi Sultanate was being present, when the last was replaced by the Mughal dynasty. And finally, at the last, it was being replaced by the Mughal Empire, and Mughal Empire came into existence. So students, what you have to do, you have to please read the chapter properly, make the flow chart of the Delhi dynasties, okay, the Delhi Sultanate, regarding which we are showing all the six major dynasties. There is the Safed dynasty, the Mamluk dynasty, okay, and then it came with the Khilji dynasty, then with the Lodi dynasty, okay, Sayyid dynasty, fine. So all these dynasties with their names and the dates, everything you have to make and draw it properly and learn it. Read the chapter properly and thoroughly. This I am repeating again with you all. Thank you for watching this video. Have a great day.